Good morning and welcome to the 28th committee meeting of our Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. And the first item on our agenda today is an evidence session with a panel of academics and experts in education policy to appreciate the progress made to date on the education reform, including the impact of recent reports and reviews on the ground. And we're interested in any progress that's been made on the implementation of the 2021 OECD report on Scotland's curriculum for excellence. So can I welcome this morning Dr. Janet Brown, who's the convener of the Education Committee at the Royal Society of Edinburgh, Professor Gordon Stobart, Emeritus Professor of Education, the Institute of Education, University College London. Good morning. Professor Walter Humes, the Honorary Professor in the Faculty of Social Sciences at the University of Stirling. And finally, Dr. Maria Shapira, the Associate Professor in Sociology at the University of Stirling also. And I'd like to move straight to questions from members. And I'll bring in, firstly, my Vice Convener, Ruth Maguire. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I'm interested to start off by hearing your reflections on curriculum for excellence. Which parts of it have been a success? Is there anything that you would have changed about curriculum for excellence?
Who would like to come in first on that one? Janet?
I think first and foremost, the philosophy of curriculum for excellence was absolutely bang on. It was about trying to think about what should be taught in schools, the way it's taught, tailoring the education so it's interesting, making sure that there are different contexts in which children can learn. And to actually, at that point, give people flexibility and allow people to have different pathways through the system, with a view to making sure that individuals in the system not only enjoyed their education, but benefited from their education and were allowed to do what they wanted to do, and came out at the end with something that was valuable. And we were supposed to be coming away from the 3-2-term dash scenario. There was a plan to do that. And there was a plan to basically make sure that there was a 3-18 curriculum that actually enabled people to have a good pathway through the system. As with any type of change, I think the implementation is always the biggest challenge. And unfortunately for CFE, implementation of significant amounts of that change happened when there was severe public pressure on funding, etc. So the whole issue of implementation became quite a big challenge. I think that a lot of benefit came from that. You can see some examples in some schools of really good progression paths and different ways in which people go through the system. I think there was a refreshment of the types of learning that was undertaken, and it gave some teachers some freedom. I think some of the challenges were associated with the preparation that was undertaken prior to the introduction, at all stages probably, of CFE. And I'll probably pass it on to someone else to continue that.
Before you do, Convener, if I could just come back in. You spoke there about implementation, and sometimes that can be a bit of a theme in terms of new works. Do you think that the implementation was a challenge? Was it understood how much resource and capacity in the classroom was understood at the time of implementing curriculum for excellence? Or do you think that, and there simply wasn't the resource there, or resources were too tight, or do you think it was that it wasn't understood at the time?
I don't think it was scoped well enough. I think if we are going to do change now, we really need to scope what we need to put in place to make it successful.
Thank you.
Walter Humes is professor.
Yes, thank you. I think Curriculum for Excellence was well-intentioned, but as I have written elsewhere, it was under-conceptualised. It wasn't thought through sufficiently. And that led to a number of problems. I didn't particularly like the word capacity, which my sources tell me was a coinage not by an educationist, but by a civil servant at a very late stage in the deliberations. And my conversation with some people who were involved in the original plan suggested that many of them would have preferred the word purposes for purposes of education. But having said that, it also failed to take sufficient account of what we have learned from the past in relation to curriculum development. There's a very well-known educationist called Lawrence Stenhouse, who worked in Scotland for a good many years, who wrote a book in the 1970s, which would have given lots of useful ideas about how to develop curriculum, and in particular, the role of teachers. Part of the problem, I think, with Curriculum for Excellence was that the messages to teachers were not sufficiently clear and they weren't as well articulated as they might have been. So teachers kept getting mixed messages. They were told at one level that this was going to be transformational. It was going to make Scottish education world class. But at another level, they were told, well, you're already doing lots of this stuff, just continue doing the good stuff you're doing at the moment. And that kind of mixed message, I think, is not helpful. And as the programme developed, there were all sorts of operational issues that arose, particularly the excessive bureaucracy which the government attempted to address in the period 2014 to 16, not wholly successfully. So lots of good intentions. Some of the ideas are certainly worth retaining. But as an example of how to move forward in curriculum development, it could have been improved.
Dr. Shapira, would you like to?
Similarly to other witnesses, what we found is that, yes, Curriculum for Excellence, it had excellent purposes to improve the depth and breadth of the education what we offer to children and young people. However, there were lots of issues with the implementation of the aims of the curriculum, and of course there were capacity issues, financial constraints, and this goes both to lack of specialist teachers, limited contact time, and things like that. But these were not the only problem, and what our recently completed study showed, one of the main problems was the demand of accountability and the culture of performativity in schools when schools are focused on attainment statistics. And this focus on attainment statistics very often comes at the expense of more pedagogical considerations. And this is when very often the declared values of the curriculum for excellence are foregone in order to provide this better attainment at the school level. And what we could see, and our study was pretty comprehensive because we not just analyzed existing data, and we also collected from the school leaders information about the provision is being that is being offered in secondary school, but we also had a number of case studies with teachers, with parents and young people to understand how curriculum decisions are being made and how choices are being made both by school teachers and young people. And we found some absolutely appalling practices, for example, channeling young people into higher performing subjects, discouraging young people from taking up a subject where they are not predicted to perform well, abandoning whole subjects which might be very important for providing a holistic, well-rounded education, but abandoning them because the subjects deemed as low performing. So for us, the culture of performativity was one of the main issues. that stand on the way of the successful implementation of the curriculum for excellence.
And finally, Professor Stobart.
You're probably aware that I'm an outsider to the Scottish system, so there'll be some things I'll get wrong. But I came in on the back of the OECD report in 2021 because they were concerned that in senior secondary, the curriculum for excellence just lost power, was their words for it, because the school exam curriculum takes over. So CFE actually fades away at that point, and we get back into some fairly traditional teaching and learning styles there. So the concern is, how do we get a better alignment between the curriculum for excellence and the assessment that goes on in senior secondary? And I think you have to say it's fairly weak at the moment. The curriculum is the exam syllabus.
Thank you, that was helpful.
Okay. That's lovely, thank you very much. So we've heard a little bit already about this in terms, so does the panel agree that the curriculum for excellence is underpinned by that active learning and how learners construct their knowledge? And if so, what practical implications does this have for teachers and other educational professionals in developing what they're teaching locally? Does anyone want to come in on that? Professor Humes? You're all sitting back and not catching my eye. It's like heads down, it's class.
We're all doing the pointing at somebody else.
Yes. We're too polite. We haven't been introduced fully into the political world yet. You used the phrase active learning. I think that was one of the problems with the beginning of Curriculum for Excellence. The phrase active learning was used without much general appreciation of what was meant by that, so that some people interpreted it as getting the children to get up and move around the classroom, for example, rather than meaning deeper intellectual engagement with the material they're being presented with, finding it challenging, having to work through problems with it, having to seek advice, having to consult sources in order to find answers to the problems that they were presented with. That's a more meaningful sense of active learning. One of the other terms that I think caused problems and continues to reverberate, interestingly, is interdisciplinary learning. And that was a phrase that I think caused a frisson of discontent and alarm in the breasts of many teachers, because they saw it as a kind of assault on their subject specialism, which, properly understood, it is not. Properly done, interdisciplinary learning has much to commend it. But there needed to be a case made to teachers for the value of interdisciplinary learning, and for a long time that case wasn't adequately made. We're now in a better position, thanks to some considerable extent to the work of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, and in particular Professor Colin Graham, and we have made progress on that. But getting a clear idea of what key concepts mean and communicating them effectively to the whole teaching force, I think, is part of the strategy that's needed.
Janet, you were name-checked there, so would you like to follow up?
Yeah, no, I also would like to thank Professor Colin Graham for his work on IDL. There is now an IDL network across Scotland where teachers can get together to try and actively engage with the true meaning of IDL. It's not just project-based. It's actually using two or three disciplines to actually solve a problem that could not be solved on its own through one individual discipline. So I think that is something that's really important. I think that the other aspect of why active learning is challenging in schools is A, the timetable, which is very rigid in a lot of places, and well, still is in most schools actually. And the other is the the disciplinary requirement that that goes all the way through the school sector and actually through into universities, if we're being very honest, because IDL is getting better in universities, but is still pretty. It's not across the board, and we're not taking sufficient advantage of it, I think. But I think that if you're a teacher of a particular subject and you have to start understanding and learning how you can engage with another subject, you need the time to do that. And that is not readily available in the current system. And therefore, for a teacher to actually go and try and do an interdisciplinary learning activity with another teacher within that school, it becomes very challenging, and it tends to go down to the lowest common denominator, because you'll do something useful, like, well, we'll do a project on ecology, which will bring in biology and physics and chemistry and stuff. But you won't actually explore the different connections between the subjects. So it goes back to time and experience. And why did that not happen? Well, number one, we didn't encourage or enable the teachers to actually develop that skill set. I think we need to think about the skill set teachers need to have over and above their individual subject and pedagogy, but the working with others, the collaboration, the understanding of different disciplines, I think is something we need to think through.
Marina, are you wanting to come in on this at all? Or you don't need to. I'm going along because we're trying to figure out, I suppose, where all your interests and expertise lie in these early questions, so we can maybe, as the session progresses, the questions might be directed at individuals. But we're.
I'd like to share some thoughts about what we found about broad general education stage provision, which I think is also an important key to understand how the curriculum for excellence is being implemented. And what we found that BGE stage, of course, it shows lots of variability. It is, the provision is different between schools, between local authorities. It is different in timing when schools introduce for the first time the subject selection, how schools navigate transition between BG to the senior phase. However, the overwhelming impression is that BG stage is very fragmented. Sometimes in a week, children are being taught by 15 teachers. And one of the main problems is that BG stage just trying to mimic the senior phase by introducing all the subjects that children would later select for national qualifications, but this very often comes at the expense of not being able to provide any in-depth learning. It comes at the expect of very limited subject content when so many subjects are being tried to provide to young children, and then sometimes they are being forced to make this early selections, every choices, and this again comes back to the culture of performativity when BGE is literally, instead of offering young people a broad holistic education, it just coaches them, prepares them to the senior phase. So it's probably that's as much as I want to tell.
Well, it goes back to your first point where it's almost selecting them for the courses they're going to perform the best in, isn't it, as well? Professor Stobart, you were nodding. Do you want to come in on this before we move
well,
to
it's
the
next? Simply to remind, I think, that Curriculum for Excellence has been widely respected internationally. I come at this from a comparative angle, and it was looked on as ahead of the game, but that was 20 years ago, and nothing stands still. But just a reminder that I don't think there's a country that isn't modernising its curriculum at the moment to try and keep up with the changes in society and the like. And I think probably as well over the last couple of years, the appearance of AI has really sort of galvanise some of this thinking as well. How do we proceed when this all this is available now for students and teachers and the like? So Scotland was ahead of the game in terms of this curriculum thinking, but how do you stay with the changes and make the adjustments that are needed? And I think I would, in a sense, backing up what's been said, is that it was admired from a distance at a general level. Nobody asked too many questions about implementations and what did the teachers do and how did they feel. It was a sort of noble ambition. And we won't go into the details of it in the classroom.
We'll have some questions on implementation later on. Pam Duncan-Glancy, do you have a supplementary on this theme before I come to my last question?
I do, if that's yes. Okay, convener. Thank you. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for the answers you've given so far and also for the information you submitted in advance, which has been helpful. I want to pick up on the point that Dr. Shapira, you made about whole subjects, in your words, being abandoned. And particularly contrary to the aspiration of the Curriculum for Excellence, fewer subjects are now studied. And there's been a decline, as you've said in your paper, in social subjects like arts and modern languages. So can I ask why you think that is and what we need to do about it?
There are several issues for that. The trend for studying less modern languages, abandoning modern languages, is a long term. It started before the Curriculum for Excellence implementation, and under of the Curriculum of Excellence, the uptake of modern languages is declining further. But we also found that the uptake of, as you said, social subjects, to an extent sciences, technological sciences, is also going down. And for us, that's, you know, you all probably heard that it is difficult to make a comparison between qualifications entries before the introduction of the Curriculum of Excellence and after, because the qualifications has also been changed, and the way they have been recorded for the official statistics this way also changed. But for us, looking at the trends under the Curriculum for Excellence and seeing these trends in the reduction of these subjects' uptakes really tells us about the curriculum narrowing. So what are the reasons? Well, the reasons are the school's focus on smaller number of subjects, and this idea that when young people are offered less subjects, they have a chance to develop better learning and to produce better outcomes on this limited number of subjects, which is not the case, as our study shows. What we found on analysis carried out at the level of schools, in schools where young people enter more qualifications in S4, in these schools more young people pass national 5 qualifications in S4. So, and there is also relationship between entry into qualifications in S4 and transitions to higher level qualifications and qualification pass in the subsequent year. So this isn't happened, but that was very often the line of thinking in the attempt to balance between the systemic demands, attainment improvement requirement, and limited resources. So why young people have been offered less social sciences subjects, because if previously it was, the norm was 7-8 subjects and young people could take up more than one social science subject, and at least taking up one social subject was a requirement, now they don't have to do it. And if they take up one social subject, it's fine. And the same is with sciences and from what we were told, children are discouraged, for example, to take up more than one science subject. Again, the concern here that they wouldn't be able to achieve good results if, for example, they study both physics and chemistry instead of just focusing on one subject. So there is a mixed bag. There's influences that I mentioned, but there are also limited school resources, there are timetable issues, and once this flexibility idea has been introduced, it was far easier to channel development into this direction and just offer less subjects and channel young people into taking less subjects than trying to tackle all surrounding issues that would allow to take the whole range of subjects.
Thank you.
Do other panel members want to contribute to that? You're okay? Right, fine. Just checking. Thanks. So I was interested to find out what the panel thought of, and if you agreed with the OECD, that the role of knowledge within the CFE requires a bit more clarification. And if so, in what way? How could the understanding of the role of knowledge be consistently understood when curriculum making happens at that local level? Janet?
I think we need to understand what knowledge should be in our curriculum as well, because the world has changed since the 20 years that Curriculum for Excellence was created. So it's what knowledge do we need? Do we need to collate facts in children, or do we actually give them the knowledge of how to access facts and how to use facts and how to identify what facts are real and what facts aren't? So for me, knowledge is absolutely a critical part of the curriculum, and it's a critical part of what you need to develop in a school or in a college or in a university or in a training provider environment. So for me, knowledge is absolutely critical. It does need to be clarified what we need to be encouraging children to learn rather than providing them with facts. I think that's a very different perspective for me. And I think teachers absolutely take great care in making sure that the children that are under their care are getting the sort of education they think they need. But as has been said by Maria on several occasions today, it's often driven by the measurement system we have. So is the knowledge that we're providing the knowledge that actually gets the merit that society currently places on national fives and highers versus actually the knowledge children and young people need to be successful in the 21st century?
Janet. Professor Stobart, do you want...
Simply to point out that we don't learn in a vacuum. We need to learn about things. There was a move for learning to learn, as if you could do it without any content. And that's just not, in my book, how it works. We need to have mastery of some information, of facts, of basics, in order to be able to think about them, use them, and that kind of deeper learning. So it is. It's a combination of asking the question, what do we need to learn now? But we do need to learn something. It's not just a kind of we just know how to do things, but we don't know anything.
Janet, again, you want to come in before I bring in?
Can I just say, I think some subjects, and being a scientist originally, I think some subjects you absolutely need to learn in a sequential way, because you need to build that knowledge in order to be able to progress. Different subjects have different approaches and different needs. So I think we need to understand that knowledge is not across the board. It's a different way of doing it, and I totally agree with the contextualisation of knowledge.
Marina? Do you want to come in on this before I bring in Walter? No?
I totally agree with the
That's good.
Previous speakers. Yeah, I think I just wanted to add that it's important for us to look also at different areas. Knowledge is important, but what schools do, they are preparing young people. Factual knowledge is important, but schools are preparing young people for the life in the 21st century. And if this is the aim, one of the aims of the curriculum, we also need to develop measures which go beyond traditional assessment on subjects that they learn to assess how well young people are prepared to this, you know, citizenship and work and life in the 21st century, and how well they're equipped, in particular by the Curriculum for Excellence, which explicitly sets these goals, and at the moment we don't have this kind of assessment in our schools.
Thank you, Marina. Professor Humes-Walter.
Yes, I agree very much with the comment in the OECD report that we need to be clear about how we position knowledge in our curriculum and as part of our educational aims. I think there was a time when we began to be less confident about knowledge because we realised we had undervalued skills. And in the attempt to adjust knowledge and skills more effectively, we perhaps became a little fuzzy about what exactly we meant by knowledge. But from my perspective, both propositional knowledge, formal knowledge, and procedural knowledge are important, and both should be strongly represented in the school curriculum. I also think, and this is a source of concern, it should be a source of concern for all of us, that knowledge and truth in our society are under serious assault from a variety of sources, not least the technology companies. So we need to be clear about what we mean by knowledge, and we need to be ready to defend it, because there are deep democratic and ethical issues involved in this debate. Nobody has an easy set of answers, but it's an issue we should be engaging with very strongly.
Thank you, Walter. And I'm just mindful of some of the meetings I've had recently regarding that very subject. But can I bring in Ben McPherson, who has a supplementary in here?
Thank you, Convener. And just building into the points that have been made in recent answers, it's my understanding, both historically and in the current situation, that the subject of English has significant prominence in the Scottish curriculum. For good reason, it's an important aspect of learning. But to have such prominence as a requirement in terms of entry to further and higher education in many cases, in a situation where individuals can learn to write in the way that suits them best in their careers, in other subjects, for example, history and other social sciences, they can learn to assess truth and validity in other subjects. How do we need to reconsider the prominence of English without downgrading its importance in the Scottish curriculum?
Okay, can I bring in Professor Humes first on that one, because you're straight ahead of me.
I should offer a confession at this point. I think I have your attention. I started my career as a teacher of English. And I value the possibilities of the English language in all its form. But I agree that the world outside schools has changed, and that different forms of communication are appropriate in different contexts, in particularly employment contexts. But I think I would want to argue for the retention of a version of English as it has been taught in the past, but perhaps looking for different indicators of a capacity to manipulate language so that the old formal essay and composition and interpretation and so on may be judged no longer as essential as they were in the past. But I think I would want to have a more extended conversation about how a reconfigured subject of English might look and what it can perhaps contribute that no other subject can, because conceptual clarity in whatever field you operate is important. You have to be able to define your terms. You have to be able to say precisely what you're hoping to achieve. You have to be able to communicate I mean, I think we've undervalued oral communication in schools for too long. So I'm interested in your question. I think I wouldn't want to sort of state a final position until we've had further dialogue about it, though. But it's a good question to ask.
Does anyone, Janet or Gordon, do you want to come in on that? And I've got Willie Rennie wanting to come in on this theme as well.
Also, as an ex-English teacher. But I think there's a whole discussion around what's English, what counts as the subject, the domain of English, because are we talking about literacy and the ability to communicate, and if so, shouldn't there be much more emphasis on oral work and the like, or are we doing literature, which is always a tendency to fall back on, you know, dead white poets and all that kind of stuff. So I think we need a good discussion about what is English, how are we seeing English, and I think the idea of being able to communicate effectively is probably at the heart of it, and knowing how to put forward an argument and use writing that way and to use speech that way. But stop.
Janet, before I bring in Mr. Rennie.
Quick one. As starting off as a scientist, and also, as you can hear from the way I speak, I haven't always been a Scot. My experience was I did English language and English literature, yeah, which was the English system, and I stopped doing that at 15 or 16, the O-level stage. But then I was put on a course of English for scientists because we were considered that we needed to continued to be able to explain things to people. But one of the things that's come up in the Royal Society's discussions, the Learned Societies group recently held an ethics session, and one of the things we talked about there was the ability for rhetoric. The fact that how have we lost the ability to argue our points? Because one of the challenges in modern society is the fact that we actually don't have good conversations and we don't have good arguments. And we aren't able to change people's minds. We sit in one space and we talk to the people who have common views that we do. But we've sort of lost that ability to have a positive engagement and a positive discussion with people of different views and have the ability to change people's minds. And this is not just Scotland, this is everywhere in the world. So the challenge for me on English is, should we add that to the English curriculum and actually get rid of the dead white poets?
Willie Rennie and Ross Greer wanting in on this, it's obviously piqued our attention.
As someone who seems incapable of persuading other people to my point of view, I'm interested in this area. But just returning to the issue about knowledge, there's some who are very vocal on this, very strident about the role of knowledge. What I really want to understand is, where are we with this in practice? Is it the scale of the problem? I understand the future threat, but where are we now? Is this deviation from knowledge a real problem, and what do we need to do to fix it?
Oh, Janet.
Can I say, first thing, we need to stop teaching to the test. We need to start allowing people to develop a broader knowledge other than what is defined in any assessment, no matter what that assessment is.
Okay. Anyone else? Maria? Marina, sorry. Sorry, Marina. You know.
Yeah, agree, and just develop more creative way of teaching too, in particular when we're talking about maths and sciences. It's and find some more creative measures of outcomes. It's not a secret that our young people, 15 years old, are underperforming on the international tests, which exactly test that they don't test knowledge of facts, unconnected facts. What they do, for example, the PISA test, it tests how well young people can use the knowledge, understand what they are being learned about, and can use it, can implement it for problem solving, and Scottish students are not doing well on these tests, and I think this is one of the way we can start thinking about it. What we teach, why do we teach, what we want the students to achieve.
Walter and Gordon both wanting in as well on this.
Yes. Thinking of your question, I don't think we have an immediate problem in the sense that most teachers are still committed to teaching formal knowledge in the areas that they have expertise in. My concern is to do with the extent to which traditional forms of grappling with knowledge, engaging with knowledge, may be being undermined by technology. So that instead of a youngster having to spend time reading things and discussing them and debating them with colleagues and answering questions by teachers, there is a tendency for some youngsters, certainly not all, to say, oh, I don't need to know that, I can look it up on Wikipedia. So that technology is seen as a sort of crutch which means that they don't have to engage with the material as strongly and in as persistent a way as perhaps was the case in the past. Actually, acquiring a body of knowledge is not an easy thing. It takes time. You encounter problems. You take wrong directions. And in the process, your cognitive structure strengthens by having to encounter these uncertainties. So that I would see that, retaining that engagement with knowledge as an essential part of any healthy educational system.
And Gordon?
Just to chip in with one point, your question really raises it. Is it in a cohesive society, what knowledge do we need in common? And I'm thinking, if we're doing it within English, what proverbs do we need? We use expressions, we use, that way. Should we be looking for a common pool of this so that we can assume that everybody can come along with that? Is that part of our duty, or do we all go our different ways?
Ross Greer, yourself on this.
Convener, I really strongly agree with Janet's point around the importance of rhetoric and Gordon's around wider communication skills. So I'd be interested in your thoughts, though, on whether those are the kind of skills that actually do need to sit inside a subject silo like English. Because when we speak to employers, they often make the point, a lot of employers don't need to know that somebody was able to get a B in higher English, but they do need to know that that person can communicate with their team, with their colleagues at work, they can communicate with a customer. Are those not exactly the kind of skills that Professor Hayward's recommendations around the diploma could recognise? You can be recognised for your communication skills, your ability to persuade, without having done 3 50-minute periods of English a week leading up to that particular exam. And actually, we need to recognise those kind of skills in that more holistic sense, rather than getting trapped in the subject silos that lead us to all the issues that were talked about before, like BGE just becoming a diluted version of senior phase, etc.
Janet Brown, yes.
Yeah, I totally and utterly agree. But we need to make sure that it is somewhere in the curriculum, because otherwise it gets lost. And I think that's where we are right now. We're losing things because they aren't in any one place. So the question is, does everything have to be subject-based, or is there something that is broader? And that, for me, is the debate that we should be having. That's a much longer-term reform than the short one. But if we don't have discussions on longer-term reform, then we will never get there. So I completely agree with you. It is something that should be across everything, because arguably one of the places that rhetoric needs to be the most important at the moment is around politics, with a big and a little p, but also around the green agenda, around whether we should what we should be as a society. So for me, it is not just English, but English is sort of the place it's always been, I think.
Walter, do you want to come in?
Yes, this is slightly provocative, but you've got to live on the edge sometime. I understand where Ross is coming from, but as he was speaking, I thought of an area where I would want to defend more traditional approaches to English. I think public discourse is in decline, as evident not just in the racier end of journalism, but also in public documents. I I lead a sad life. I spend a lot of my time reading minutes, reports, committee documents, and I'm often pretty shocked at the poor standard of English in them. So that for certain purposes, particularly in a legislative chamber, absolute precision and clarity of language is essential. In fact, not to have it would be to undermine the democratic process. So I'm not saying that everybody has to have that level of linguistic skill, but we need to have it somewhere in the educational system.
Gordon?
Following up on that, really, in terms of the examination system, what role does oral communication play? If you look at the baccalaureate, look at other systems, students are expected to make oral contributions to defend themselves orally. If you get down to a pencil and paper exam system, there's no demand on that. So that becomes a curriculum issue as well. Where do we weight oral contributions? How can we encourage them? And it is across subjects, because you can, as a historian, you can defend a piece and think, but we don't have room for that in the British system.
Marina?
I'll just put my university lecturer hat on here. And for years, I'm observing the very poor writing, English language writing skills among our Scottish students. English students write much better. And our Scottish students are being admitted to our program with requirement of higher A or at least B in English. Unless they're coming with advanced higher, they can't write logically, coherently, they can't construct an argument, they can't critically engage with writing. They learn. By year four, almost everyone can do it, and in the way that, you know, supports your point about should we introduce these writing communication skills within every subject, because every subject requires better communication. I'm just not sure it is possible to do in schools. I think in schools we need to have this dedicated subject of English, which improves their ability to express themselves in writing coherently, because my understanding is that this is not that being done, and young people are being encouraged to write almost in bullet points in many subjects. And we then face this problem in the universities.
Thank you very much. As the convener, I have to always keep my eye on the clock, and I'm very apologetic to my fellow committee members that the questions by the convener and vice-convener have taken this length of time to get through, but it's been really, really important evidence that we've been taking. So can I move now to questions from Stephanie Callaghan, and thank you for your patience.
Thank you, convener, and I think we could all talk about this all day, to be quite honest with you. But I'm going to move on and talk about implementation, which I know isn't always a really, really popular word. But there's been that kind of increase in focus, I suppose, on applying and carrying through changes in education systems. And a number of different models of change have been suggested too. So I'm wondering, what is the panel's view on how we best turn policy into practice? And maybe I'll start with yourself, Janet.
Well, I think the first thing is we need to think really carefully. We need to think about unintended consequences. We need to think about an overarching policy that encompasses all education skills. You know, we started off with 3 to 18. We ended up with primary phase, BGE, senior phase, colleges, universities, etc. I think we need to think about the implementation needs to think about how we do it as much as what we're going to do, and try and address as many of the identified unintended consequences that we can. We need to learn from the past, because I think we have a brilliant learning scenario here for how we implemented CFE, and we need to be honest about it, and we need to be willing to say what really has worked and what really hasn't. And not just focus on one area, because I think if we look at the OECD reports, they highlighted several areas that needed change, and we tend to focus on one or two of those areas for change, which can drive the system but are not going to be a solution to the full thing. So I think it's learning from the past, which Walter has already said. I think it is about thinking about how we do it, engaging across the piece. But the other big thing for me on implementation is taking Scotland with us. It's not just schools and pupils and learners and parents. It is Scotland itself, because one of the big issues, I think, with Curriculum for Excellence was Scotland didn't really buy into the change in the senior phase. And I think unless we get a change, if we decide to implement Louise Haywood's recommendations, which I think are excellent, then I think we need to make sure that Scotland buys into that and we don't slip back into what is comfortable and what we did and what we learnt. Because what I learnt definitely when I was growing up, is not going to fit me if I were to live till 2050. It would not serve me well. And we should not be doing that to our young people.
I suppose just to actually pick up on that there as well a bit. Certainly culturally in Scotland, we have this thing of this pride in, you know, teaching our children to read, to write, etc. as well. Are there barriers? Is the kind of cultural shift for the wider public, is that a bit of a barrier to it? And how do we address that?
Well, I think Marina has highlighted the fact that the measurement system drives what happens. And I think, historically, the only qualifications that were discussed were the ones that came out in the summer. And that's not what the vast majority of people in Scotland would like to do, or would actually benefit Scotland by doing. And I think we need to look at our measurement system. We need to look at what we value as a society. I'll give the example of my children who did really well at school, and my friends couldn't understand why they weren't becoming lawyers. And the answer is they didn't want to. We have an aspiration level in Scotland, and we have an aspiration to get as many children and young people as possible into university. Is that what Scotland needs? Is that what our young people need? We need to ask that question and be honest about it.
I suppose it's about what we value then.
It's what we value.
Yeah. So interested in what the other panel members have got to say there about turning policy into practice.
Walter.
I think central to successful implementation is winning the hearts and minds of teachers. Because at the end of the day, it is the teachers who deliver the new policy. Although I would be slapped over the wrist for using the word deliver. One of the problems that we face, and we've faced it for quite a long time, it's not a very recent development, is that there has been a loss of trust and confidence among teachers in the policies that they're being asked to promote, and in particular the leadership of many of those who promote them. We have a culture where teachers are too often expected to ask only how questions and when questions, never why questions. To implement a policy successfully, you have to persuade people. You have to make the case. And if there is a good case, teachers are reasonable people. They will listen to the case and either agree with it or say, OK, but I'm not too happy with this bit of it. And you then have a constructive dialogue. It's also required that the policy is communicated more widely, not just to classroom teachers, but to all stakeholders, especially parents, and society at large, because public education is a civic good. It's an important bulwark of democracy. And so you have to have as many citizens as possible buying in to this vision of where we're going in the educational system. So I think we need to be quite honest that teachers haven't always been presented with the case, an intellectual case. One of the things I say, and it's never terribly popular, is that we've had a lack of intellectual leadership in Scottish education to make the case. There's been too much cosy conformity of rehashing the same concepts and ideas and everybody saying we're doing a fine job. That is not going to produce the world-class educational system that I think we all want. So there's going to be uncomfortable discussion that will have to take place, and it will involve not just teachers' leaders, it will involve politicians, it will involve leading figures in the big educational bureaucracies, it will involve inspectors, it will involve civil servants. The role of civil servants in policy development and implementation, in my view, requires much greater scrutiny than it has received hitherto. And so there will be a period of disruption to engage in that kind of intellectual argument. Yet I said I was going to be mildly controversial.
I know on that theme, we have questions on that specifically later on from one of Mr. Kidd. Stephanie, carry on, please.
I don't know if anybody else wanted to contribute on that point.
Support Professor Hume's point. We need to answer the question, what secondary education is for, what we want to produce. I don't think it's a bad thing to preparing young people well for transiting into the higher education, but definitely that shouldn't be the only aim. And also, how do we measure this preparedness? We need to reconsider how we assess knowledge, not just how we deliver knowledge, but how we assess it and what we assess, and if this assessment fit for purpose. And it definitely needs to be changed. And what is happening at the moment, again, going back to the importance, when you talk to school leaders and teachers and you talk about the most influential factors that affect their curriculum making processes and decisions, they always talk about systemic issues, they always talk about demands to increase attainment. And once you have this demand, you focus, the schools have limited resources. And these limited resources are being focused on higher level of subject delivery. And those young people who are taking the subjects on lower levels of national qualifications, they are not getting adequate provision and they are suffering. So there's clear equity issue here in the way how at the moment these external demands affect the school resources and the delivery of the curriculum. And this really needs to stop, because we have those who are not going to take up these subjects on national 5 or higher levels. These young people are suffering from inadequate provision.
Okay. Gordon.
This may be uncomfortable, but coming from the outside, I am amazed by how much committees, discussions, consultations, Scotland keeps spinning the plates all the time. And I wonder, how do you make a decision in a structure like this, where you've got all these different groups contributing? It leads to inaction, as far as I come as a pragmatist who would want to say, actually, something needs to be done. I'm aware that structural changes are being made. I'm not sure I see a great deal else. So we talk a lot about the higher order stuff and the need for a vision and everything else. As a pragmatist, I just want to say, and what's the first step? Where do we go on this to start making change? How do you eat an elephant one bite at a time? What's the first bite here? I come with a particular brief that I would want to look at the assessment system and the exam system. What I would say as well is that you can't add stuff without taking stuff away. You can't say to teachers, here's another good idea we'd like you to do. In order to do that, we have to clear some space. You'll have seen my views is that Scotland has a really cluttered examination system that I think is probably counterproductive. Scottish students are more heavily examined than I think anybody else in the world. Actually, I don't dare say that too strongly, but probably, like they do with Carlsberg, probably. Nowhere else has three sets of examinations in 3 years. Most now have moved to just one set of qualifications at 18. Most of your students stay on to 17 or 18. So for me, I mean, there's a point there, a bit of an edge that something could be done to change the system. But this is me from a very personal comparative point of view there.
Ordinate that my colleagues will be asking some questions around this later on, but I'm really interested in what you said there about, you know, there's more and more and more and more information coming, and actually there need to be decisions and steps made forward. Is that kind of about the idea that having too large a group taking those decisions kind of keeps you with the status quo because you can't all agree, and it's maybe you need that small group to kind of lead forward and take that
lead? I think it needs some policy leadership, yes. And I think, is there a tendency to say if we can't, these two groups aren't agreeing, we'll set up another group to get a consensus about it, and so it goes on, rather than saying we've really got to get down to some practical steps in what we need. And it's always there's always going to be objections. You can't have a reform without somebody, some vested interest, you know, being upset by it.
And of course, two more groups were announced yesterday. In the exactly. Okay. Can I, Stephanie Callaghan? Have you got any more?
Just a small question, okay. To yourself, Walter. You spoke about teachers and winning hearts and minds. So you kind of took the words out of my mouth on that one. And I'm wondering as well, you know, teachers themselves too have such a wide range of views too. So how do we actually bring that together and have them moving forward together as well?
I think the aim in Scottish education for a very long time, and this predates devolution, has always been to reach a consensus. Now, you can get a measure of consensus in terms of educational policy, but to expect complete consensus is, I think, not just over-optimistic, I think it's not entirely desirable either. I think there should always be questions that are left open to be revisited at a later date. For some educational issues, there may be a case for running two policies and seeing which of them actually produces better outcomes. So, yes, it's going to be difficult, and teachers often tend to be temperamentally inclined to be conservative. They prefer the familiar. I think that's true of all of us in most spheres of life. But they are open-minded people if a good case is put to them. And that's where I think we haven't done as much as we need to. There was a tendency to say, when Curriculum for Excellence was introduced, that this will liberate teachers, that they will have autonomy to make decisions. But since they had lived under a regime in which they were previously told exactly what to do, making that transition was never going to be easy, and some of them didn't believe it. So they kept their heads down. They perhaps paid lip service to the new policy, but continued to do what they had always done. It's always possible to find subversive ways of responding to policies that you don't like. I think we need to be open to more vigorous debate and not go for the easy consensus too quickly. I sometimes say, in my more critical modes, this is not one of them this morning, by the way, I sometimes say that Scottish teachers are ambivalent. On the one hand, they say, we are professionals, we should be making these judgments ourselves, On the other hand, they often say in a jaded voice, just tell me what to do and I'll do it. Now, that kind of professional response is not the kind of professional response I would want to see. I want to see a profession which is vigorously engaged with ideas, in which they engage in collaborative projects together, and they work through pedagogic problems in teams and learn from each other. And there is some evidence that that's going on. I know that work with Mark and Marina at Stirling, and also another colleague, trying to remember her name, Mark's colleague who works with...
Sarah Meaning.
No, it will come to me. But they've done excellent work with schools and local authorities engaging in precisely that kind of professional collaborative project that I was referring to. So consensus, you have to have a measure of consensus, but to aim for complete consensus is, I think, probably mistaken.
So a measure of consensus and flexibility on how you reach there. Thank you.
Valerie Drew is the name of the other colleague.
Well done, getting that on record. And before we actually move to questions from Bill Kidd, Marina wants to come in on that
just
as well, Stephanie.
Just wanted to offer some empirical evidence that backs everything that Professor Humes said. And our study indeed shows, and our conversations with teachers, focus groups with teachers shows that teachers, A, very often don't really understand what they're supposed to do. They don't fully understand curriculum for excellence. But there is also a lack of capacity in terms, for example, of non-contact time for teachers to actively engage in the curriculum-making processes. And here, providing teachers with this ability, providing them with more non-contact time for collaboration within schools, but also for collaboration across schools, subject teachers, across different schools, creating networks, taking the leadership for the curriculum development. These are the things that can really help with implementation.
Time for collaboration and debate is absolutely vital. Thank you.
Bill Kidd, can I come to you now, please? Thanks very much.
Yes, thanks very much. Well, when I attended school, I did learn one thing, which is to listen to what people are saying. So I have heard a great deal of what you're going to say, but I'm still going to ask you these questions anyway, because we're in the Scottish Parliament. We need to have a wee bit of talk about politics and how it's handled. So we know about the roles of national and local government in supporting policy change in education and even driving it. How do the panel suggest balancing these traditional top-down implementation processes with more bottom-up approaches? And I know a bit of that's been covered already, actually, but it's mixing the two together somehow. How do you think that might be done, please?
Who would like to go first on that one? Go on, Professor Humes.
Yes, good question. It is highly political. The territory is contested, shall we say. And one of the reasons that we're looking at proposed structural reforms is the perception that Education Scotland, in particular, was too directive from the centre, was seen to be too close to Scottish Government, and that a insufficient scope was given to local authorities, to head teachers and to schools. And of course there was the empowerment agenda, which was introduced by John Swinney a few years ago. That was a kind of compromise because he wanted to limit the powers of local authorities more than they were content with. So there was a deal struck, and we have the empowerment agenda, which does give more scope to local authorities. It has, to some extent, reduced the centralist role of Education Scotland, although that kind of trench warfare is still going on, I think. The major thing that was introduced, though, were the regional improvement collaboratives. There are six regional improvement collaboratives in Scotland where groups of local authorities pool their expertise, their resources, they share ideas, and they have more scope than used to be the case to try things out in their particular localities. Now, it's slightly complicated in that the heads of these regional improvement collaboratives are employees of the local authority, of one of the local authorities involved. So they must have a bit of conflict of loyalty between the fact that the local authority pays their salary, but they're expected to do something that deviates from the traditional pattern. There have been two reviews of the activities of the regional improvement collaboratives. They are variable. Some seem to be functioning better than others. There's been clearly quite a lot of good work going on at local level. The difficulty in the more recent evaluation is that it's quite hard to demonstrate that any impact derives from the regional improvement collaborative and not from other things that are going on anyway. So proving an impact is actually very tricky. But there are attempts to express the principle of subsidiarity, that you allow some decision making to be taken at the lowest possible level where it's going to have a direct effect, rather than have, you know, as in the French system, missives being sent out from Paris, which all schools throughout the country are expected to follow. So we're still grappling with that, but as your preamble suggested, it's a thorny political issue.
On the back of that, what are the panel's views on how structural reform of the SQA and Education Scotland will support this approach for better outcomes for children and young people? Because I'm not meaning this wrongly, but it's really supposed to be about children and young people, isn't it, rather than the process itself. So how will that deliver, do you think, please?
Gordon, do you want to come in first on that one? Or?
I don't feel I'm in a position.
Okay, that's fine. Just when you gesticulated your hand, I'm just trying to gauge your signals.
Just agreeing with what I said.
Janet?
I think we need to understand what structural reform is going to do. I know there have been questions, are we just changing the nameplate? And what is going to be the difference? What are we trying to achieve with structural reform, I think, is a really critical question. And you know, I'm not trying to defend anything here. I'm trying to ask the question of exactly why, exactly what are we trying to do, what was the exact problem, and how is this going to fix it? And really sit down and work that out before we go about doing it. Because I think there, irrespective of what structural reform we're talking about, because there's obviously the Willetts review as well, there's the purpose and principles review. We've got a whole series of reviews, as Gordon has pointed out, that have come out with recommendations. And currently, the Royal Society of Edinburgh's Education Committee is looking at all of them together, because we don't particularly want to respond to each one individually, because it's not very satisfying doing that. So what we're doing is looking at them all together and trying to understand where they overlap, where they conflict potentially, where they actually reinforce each other, because there is one educational system here. And I think the opportunity cost of any sort of structural reform needs to be thought through, and also the unintended consequences on other aspects of the system. I noticed in the Cabinet Secretary's comments yesterday about the fact that from the SQA's perspective, it will continue its international agenda. The branding of that has an implication on their ability to actually operate internationally, for instance. When the colleges were reformed, there were unintended consequences associated with the change in the structure and the change in the governance mechanism for the colleges. So I think we just need to think carefully about what are the unintended consequences and what are the costs of that level of radical change, both in terms of expertise that's available in terms of what could be done in that period of time and the time that's lost through institutional reform.
Do you think there could be a danger of throwing the baby out with the bathwater if we change it too radically, too quickly?
I don't know. I'd like to know somebody else's thought about it.
Right.
Professor Humes, yourself?
Thank you. This is an area that I've written about quite a lot, so please stop me if I show signs of wittering on for too long. In Scotland, when there's been a recognition of the need to make change, the automatic response has always been to make structural change, to, you know, play around with the agencies. And of course, in a way, we are where we are at the moment because a political decision was taken two cabinet secretaries ago to replace SQA and reform Education Scotland. That was a political decision. 2 years further on, there seems to have been a bit of a loss of nerve. The process has slowed down a bit. Now, partly, I suspect, that's because of the legislative programme. Partly, I suspect, it's because of cost concerns. But in what I've written, I've often said structural issues are not the principal problem that we face. I think we have got plenty of structures. In fact, in some ways, Scottish education is trapped in its own bureaucracy. There are just so many agencies with so many people meeting again and again in different arenas, revisiting the same issues and coming to no very firm conclusion. The real problems of Scottish education are cultural rather than structural. They're to do with power and the capacity of key players to defend their interests, their territories, and to stop things happening. And in one of the papers I submitted, I said that if we want to bring about cultural change, and cultural change was highlighted in both the OECD report and the report of the International Council of Education Advisors, they both said cultural change is essential. Structural change without cultural change will not achieve what we want it to achieve. And the point I make is that for cultural change to happen, it has to start at the top. It has to start in the way that politicians, national and local, operate. It must involve the chief executives of national agencies, inspectors, directors of education, and senior civil servants. And that is the challenge, I think, that faces your committee, and indeed Scottish education generally.
And I know, Professor, we have a member about to pick up on that very theme very shortly, so you'll be able to go into a little bit more detail on there. Mr Kidd, have you got any...
No, that's fine. Thank you very much for that.
Well, that's an absolutely wonderful segue to the line of questioning we now have from Michelle Thompson.
And it's me that's going to pick up that thread. Let's just carry it on for a minute and then some other areas I want to bring it in. I must admit, I read your paper with great interest, Professor Humes, and the comments you're making. I think we, based on what you've said, we've got a good sense of the role that culture plays in delivery in terms of national governments and agencies. You've already put that on the record. But in your opinion, how would you go about changing that? Because changing culture is extraordinarily difficult to do, very time consuming, and often agencies at whatever level get rather tired of it for that very reason and move on to something else. So, question for you, how would you go about changing the scenario you've already depicted in your comments?
There is no quick fix. It takes time. And that's one of the reasons why politicians get impatient with it, because the timescale of politicians is usually quite short-term. They want to be able to demonstrate that they've achieved something before the next election. If you're trying to change a culture, you have to take a long-term view. And it requires a number of things. It's not a single thing. It requires the people at the top that I mentioned to start looking at themselves rather carefully and saying, you know, are we exercising power in the best interests of children in schools and their parents and the community at large? It needs to involve teacher education. You need to start at the early stages of a teacher's career by encouraging them to ask the kind of questions that at the moment they tend not to be encouraged to ask. The why questions. Why are we doing this? And also encourage them to be creative and experimental and innovative. I was interested in one of the things the Cabinet Secretary said recently when she said she wanted to reset the government's relationship with the teaching profession. And I thought that's an admirable thing to want to do. I think because there has been an issue of trust and confidence, the fact that the Cabinet Secretary is seeing that and wanting to do something about it is to be welcome. She linked that to her proposal to set up a Centre for Teaching Excellence. But without giving much detail, and she was criticised for not having consulted anybody about it beforehand. And my thought was, I'm not sure you want to retain the term excellence in the title. I would prefer a centre for teaching innovation, because we've got lots of challenges in education. We've mentioned AI before, and I think that's a big one, and very few people in Scotland seem to be addressing it. There is some interesting work in England, which I can mention if you want me to say a bit more about it later. But the way in which teachers are initiated into the profession and encouraged to ask the why questions and to put forward their own ideas and try things out, that begins to change the culture, albeit in small, modest ways to begin with, but it creates a less formal, a less hierarchical situation, and it involves distributing power more evenly. And it's important that the people on the front line feel they have agency to do things. So you're talking about a 10-year programme. Most politicians don't really want to know that. But if we want to change culture, we have to start looking at that kind of issue.
And can I bring anybody else in the panel specifically on this question about how do we go about changing that? Perhaps you're looking at me, Janet.
I should look somewhere else. I think culture is actually at the heart of all of this. And Walter touches on the culture in the education system, but the culture outside the education system has a huge impact on what we do in education. And I think that's an even harder thing to change because you have no control over that at all. And I think if you look at the areas of the world that have done things well in terms of persuading their populace that something's better, is they've had a really, really good advertising campaign. If you look at what happened in 2020 in the first COVID year, if you look at what happened in Southern Ireland, about how they engaged with their population on what was happening with the examination system and the qualification system there. They really went to the level of drawing cartoons and explaining to the population that this is why we're doing this. And so the nature of the engagement with society was taken really seriously and was not academic. It was this is why it's going to be beneficial. So if you want to change the culture of the way in which people think about career pathways in school, because one of the things I get very frustrated about is the fact that we still, after multiple years of talking about it, do not have parity of esteem between academic qualifications, vocational qualifications. If we take that as an example, how do we actually try change people's cultural view on that? We change people's cultural view by actually explaining to people that actually Today, if you're a welder, you're going to earn far more than an academic in a university is going to. Not only are you going to do that, you might actually have a great career and enjoy yourself, and you'll have a happy life, and you'll have something you want, and actually you'll enable us to regenerate the industry in Scotland. Similarly, you know, we have a huge challenge with regard to the existing building stock in Scotland in terms of getting it ready to actually enable us to get anywhere near our net zero goals. So how do we actually go about changing the culture of people aspiring that their kids are going to actually go and be heating engineers? And the value of that to society, but the value of that to them as human beings as well. We all too often think about it in two different sections. We have conversations, and we do this at the Royal Society. You know, we've got an Economy and Enterprise Committee that has one level of language. We talked about language earlier. And they talk about, well, we need these skills, we need these people, we need this. And then we've got an Education Committee that talks about, well, how do we help people develop? We need one language that actually says there is a mutual beneficial relationship between what the country needs, what the industry needs, and what people need. And so it's a complex issue. I totally agree with Walter that this is not a quick fix, but it's about how do we engage with the general population in a meaningful conversation to real people, not just politicians and academics and educationalists, that actually enables us to see a different future.
Yes, go ahead.
Gordon, thank you.
It strikes me that the acid test of any reform that we're talking about, any structural change, anything else, the fundamental question each time is, what difference is this going to make to the classroom? What difference will it make to teaching, how teachers teach, and how learners learn? And if we can't answer that question for any higher level structural or whatever training reform, why are we doing it? Because that seems to me to be the focus, it should be our focus of any moves we make, should be able to answer that question to some extent.
And just following on from that, the International Council of Education Advisors view is that Scotland should aim for an egalitarian culture in education. What does an egalitarian culture mean to you, and do you agree? Perhaps, Marina, you might like
Fear in their eyes.
I think Scotland can be proud of its approach to this, and the emphasis on equality and the like doesn't mean we get it socially or... One of the issues that I think, and it's been a debate here in Scotland as well, about examinations, going to my narrow little world, is that examinations are fairer than other ways. And I'm not sure about that at all, because there's equality in that you all sit down and do the same thing for the same time, but that's not the same as equality of preparation. And so some have an advantaged teaching and learning situation and everything, and the subjects they can take. I think Marina's research is really powerful on this. It undercuts the rhetoric about we've all got the same opportunities. When you find out, when you're more forensic, you find out, no, you don't. Some schools really narrow you down. Others broaden you out. So I think that the fact that you have a largely comprehensive system, and that has been maintained, I think is a great strength. I come from England, obviously, and I wouldn't say that of our system there, where the privileged just keep on being privileged.
Marina, obviously I'd like to bring you in.
I think in principle our secondary education is egalitarian, but we have an issue of equity because we have quite a wide variation in the provision by the characteristics of learners and characteristics of schools they attend, characteristics of neighbourhoods they live. What we found in our study is that, for example, curriculum narrowing is a socially stratified process. Students who are attending schools in the areas of social and economic deprivation, they experience the curriculum narrowing to a much greater extent than those who attend the schools in more advantageous areas. Similarly, lots of unintended consequences from the curriculum narrowing and from the introduction of new curriculum, again, are being experienced by those who attend schools in disadvantaged areas to a bigger extent. For example, the idea of introducing flexibility in the curriculum was very laudable and allowing young people not to take up all their national five-level qualifications in 1 year and instead to spread it over the years and to allow the young people to catch up. The data shows that what in fact is happening is that this is happening in schools which are located in the disadvantaged areas. Those who attend schools in better areas, they are following the old pattern of qualification uptake. They take all their national five qualifications in S4, all their higher qualifications in S5. There are those young people who attend disadvantaged schools, they take less qualifications on national five level in S4 and then trying to take more qualifications in S5. As a result, they take less higher qualifications and so on and so forth. But the interesting thing that overall there is a decline in the uptake of national five qualifications in S5, which means that this promised flexibility didn't happen. It just sort of shifted the problem towards disadvantaged schools and gave it as the second best option to young people to catch up with these qualifications. And this is just one of the examples, and it's the same when we look at the way the curriculum provision works. Huge variability starting from BGE stage. Schools have so many different models of provision. The initial idea was 3+3, but what's happened, many schools in advantageous areas, they usually follow 2+2+2. 2 years for BGE, 2 years for national five qualifications, 2 years for higher advanced arts qualifications. Schools in disadvantaged areas, they sometimes follow 2+1+1+1 model, which brings to a very fragmented learning. And these are the issues that exactly needs to be looked at if we want equitable education, equitable educational experiences.
Led on to the next bout of questions, convener.
Before we go to Liam Kerr, though, we have a wee supplementary, hope you'll make it concise, from Ben McPherson. Thanks.
Thank you, convener. Just touching on what Professor Hume said about the political discourse and political decision-making, I just wondered if there's any further elaboration that you could give to that, If there's a shift in political consciousness that needs to happen in terms of how we discuss education reform to make sure that there is a sense of at least medium, hopefully long-term consideration that happens at a parliamentary level. Because you know, I think of some of the challenges with, for example, the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence. And I'll just ask the question.
Okay, sorry, I did ask for something a bit more succinct, Ben.
Okay, again, quite a challenging question. I often refer to an American political theorist called Murray Edelman, who talks about the shift to what he sees as policy as spectacle. And he has detected a trend, both in the United States and in other countries, that policy making is now seen as a social spectacle, so that politicians come up with a fresh new idea, or an apparently fresh new idea, it may be a recycled idea, which I suppose is environmentally friendly. And it's launched, particularly if it's a new minister, it's launched with all sorts of razzmatazz, with photo opportunities and smiling children. And it's bigged up. The language is bigged up. We live in a boastful age. Everything is exaggerated. Nothing is promising or quite good. Everything is awesome or spectacular. Now, if that's a general trend, and I think it is a general trend, fueled by social media, by advertising, by television. You even see it on the BBC all the time now, with all their hyped-up trailers for programmes that you don't want to see at all, especially if they include the word celebrity in it. But if that is a general trend of political language, it's not healthy. It's not the only trend. There's also a sort of cosy, feel-good kind of discourse that you see. I want a much more hard-headed kind of political discourse in which things are described as they are, in which ideas are engaged with at a proper intellectual level. It's not all about promotion and advertising and getting the headline in tomorrow's press. Education is important. It should be about real issues, real aspirations, realistic aspirations, not overhyped, not boasted about. And in that sense, the question of discourse that you raise is an ongoing issue. And I would like to see more people commenting on it and saying, hold on a minute, that kind of discourse is not helpful.
Thank you very much for that. We do have a lot of questions, the panellers, we're wanting to still present to you, so perhaps if we make sure our questions and our answers are as succinct as possible. And I'm going to limit all supplementaries now till the end to see if we've got time, if you don't mind. Liam Kerr, over to you now, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Professor Humes, picking up on comments that you made much earlier in this session, the OECD has suggested that the Scottish system might be too heavily governed. And my question to you is, do you recognise that as an issue? And if so, how does it square, if at all, with the principle of subsidiarity, which you described earlier as decisions being made at the lowest suitable level and which is core to curriculum for excellence?
Yes, I think the OECD is quite right in the sense that they suggest that the system is overgoverned. One of the questions that concerned me both with SQA and with Education Scotland was how close they were to government. And I think that national agencies, obviously they are accountable in a sense to government, but they need a degree of distance. And one of the things that we discussed in Ken Muir's committee, I was a member of the expert panel on that, was what happens to the inspectorate. And we recommended that the inspectorate should report to the Scottish Parliament, not to the Scottish Government. And that was quite a deliberate thing. The Scottish Government, of course, is not very keen on that because it means that they have less control. The principle of subsidiarity has only really appeared on the agenda quite recently, and local authorities are quite keen on it. But I think we're quite a long way from actually embodying a principle of subsidiarity. It's seen as an aspiration. I think we need to do more work on it. But the desire for central control is very persistent. And the desire for the traditional policy community to exercise control is very persistent, and it extends before devolution. It was there well before devolution. A wonderful book by Andrew McPherson and Charles Rabb called Governing Education set out how the policy community in Scottish education operated. And somebody in 2015 a study of comprehensive education by Danny Murphy and colleagues at Edinburgh University. He said that McPherson and Rabb's policy community is alive and well in 2015.
Thank you. Dr. Brown, you talked earlier about what we value and what our aspirations might be for, in and for the education system in Scotland. Do you take a view on how the performance of the education system should be measured at both a local and a national level? And do you take a view on whether we should move from individual accountability to a more collective responsibility, as Professor Chapman has argued?
I think it is important that we do assess what is happening in the education system, and because that assessment should be useful. It should not just be a tool with which to maybe beat people if they haven't achieved something. So assessment should be, we should assess the education system as a whole, because we need to know whether it is being successful. We should assess individual institutions, because we should make sure that they are performing to the area, to the level that we expect them to be. But we also should be looking at whether one approach works better than another approach, recognising that different scenarios and different environments will mean that could have impact on it. I think Walter's talked about the fact that, you know, maybe we should be trying out two different things. There has always been the view in Scotland that when we roll something out, we roll it all out together. Everything goes at one pace. Should we actually be piloting things and then assessing whether that is working better than this other thing that we're trying over here, so that we ultimately get to the point that we start to improve the system because we understand what's going on? And from that perspective, it's a collective assessment. It's not an individual child perspective. But if you don't allow for assessment, and I'm careful to use the word assessment, not qualifications or anything else, if you don't assess how an individual learner is doing, if there isn't an assessment, let me say it properly, if there isn't an assessment of how an individual learner is doing, then there is no mechanism of being able to identify what additional work needs to be done to make sure that individual learner is successful. And that can be done by the teacher, it can be done in completely different environments, but you need to be able to identify what's going well and what's not going well at the system level, at the individual level. And I think if you do that, you have to be really careful, because society, and this goes back to the change in the culture, society takes any measure that anybody takes on education and uses it to address the agenda that they want to achieve. So, you know, we've got to be careful of how we use the measurement system that we put in place, and we use it in the right way, and we are vocal, politicians are vocal about when it is being misused and misrepresented.
Thank you. Dr. Shapira, you talked earlier about teacher capacity, and there has been lots of talk down the years. We have in our papers a reference to a 2013 study about improving capacity of teachers and the necessity for it, both at an individual but also at a structural and cultural level. Can you describe how effective have efforts been to improve the capacity of teachers looking backwards? And looking forwards, where ought the focus to be to improve capacity within the system, particularly if, as Professor Stobart said earlier, what mustn't happen is adding without taking away?
Well, I can rely on the findings from our study, and it doesn't seem that the teacher's capacity, from what we learned, that this capacity increased or have been improved. Teachers are overworked. Teachers are complaining on lack of non-contact hours to do anything else rather than go into the classrooms and teach. And to us, it would be one of the keys improving resources, increasing resources, and then allowing teachers to have more non-contact time if we want teachers to be able to use their agency and actively participate in the curriculum making and improving learning for students. So we didn't find that there were some visible improvements compared to what it was.
Thank you. Unless any of the other panellists want to respond on any of those questions, I'll hand back to the convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Can we now move to some questions from Willie Rennie, please? Thank you.
Yesterday's statement, I'm interested in your views about particularly the qualifications decision. I think there was a frustration amongst us that we thought we were going to get some kind of move forward, but we're getting a new debate in the new year, and I'd be interested in what your view is on that. Perhaps Professor Humes could first.
Well, it reinforces the impression that I had before yesterday's announcement that there was an inclination to delay big decisions. And I think that will be seen with a degree of disappointment by many in the system, because they feel it's been going on long enough and it's time to take some decisions. And big decisions are not easy, but in the world of politics, there comes a point when you have to reach policy closure and take the decisions and live with the consequences. And this whole process was set in motion by one of the Cabinet Secretary's predecessors. I think delay, while it will be welcome with the old guard, as I call them, in the Scottish educational system, those who don't want to have their territorial reach disturbed in any way, I think it will actually disappoint a lot of teachers too, because they get to the point where they simply want a decision to be taken, and they can then see what this means for them in terms of their subject, their school, their community. I think it is disappointing. Having said that, I think there are some things in Professor Hayward's report that do need further interrogation. In particular, project learning, the implications of that, for the practical implications of that for staffing and timetabling. I was at a presentation by Professor Hayward recently in which she was very well received, but there was a head teacher from Ayrshire who said the project learning proposal, which is one of the areas that is strongly recommended in the report, would be virtually impossible to implement in my school because of the staffing level that I have, and that there is, he said, and I don't have the information to hand to confirm this, but I don't think he was making it up. He said there were considerable variations in staffing levels across different authorities in schools. So some of them might be well placed to take up the challenge of project learning. Others might struggle just to do the traditional learning. So there are issues that do need to be fleshed out, but that's not in itself a reason for saying stop the buses.
Right. Professor Stobart.
Yes, I was sitting on a train all day yesterday, so I missed the announcement, but I was brought up to speed this morning, and the idea that once again we're halting to do more consultation, just a reminder that this is Scotland, and you're doing this if it's stalling or if it's moving very slowly. The rest of the world is getting on with this kind of thing, and there are reforms going on everywhere. Even the French baccalaureate is being reformed, and that takes some doing. And New Zealand and other countries are all looking at ways of bringing the assessment system and the curriculum up to date. And if there's this ongoing internal debate in Scotland, but no movement, dare I say, don't be surprised if you find others have gone past you in the time.
With the others, I could encourage them just to comment on what the Cabinet Secretary said about the reasons why. I mean, she was talking about issues around behaviour, you know, post-COVID, the real challenge and the poverty-related attainment gap. She said, basically, they've got enough on their plate just now. We need to consider whether we should move forward with this when all these other things are going on. Do you think there's any merit in that argument, Dr Brown?
From the membership of the committee, we've got several people working in schools and in the directors of educational offices. And from what we hear, there is a significant issue associated with the change in the nature of the children that are coming through the schools after COVID. So I think there is a big issue there. But I am disappointed that we aren't moving ahead in general. So I think the reasons are valid, but there will always be another reason coming around the corner. We didn't do something because of the financial crisis. We're not doing this because of COVID. I agree with Professor Stubbart. If we don't do something, we will fall behind. And I think it's really, really critical that we think it through. We think it through. But Scotland will never, ever reach consensus on its qualification structure. And we just need to accept that. And somebody needs to take a decision and take the leadership and do something.
Dr. Shapiro.
I would agree with this view because there are always lots of complicated issues, and there's always going to be another issue, but there is a clear need to look at qualifications and think if we want to stick to the existing structure or maybe making some changes and shifts, maybe moving back towards speaking about SCQF levels rather than national qualifications, and that would allow us to make what we already mentioned, bringing vocational qualifications in rather than just focusing on the performance. And the same is about assessment. There's a huge need to look at the traditional assessment methods, and that manifested itself during the COVID, and we all remember what happened in 2020. So there's real need to reconsider what we assess, how we assess, and maybe the questions of equity with the existing forms of assessment. Again, we saw that it is not working, and think about creatively. And we are living in the 21st century. Why do we still stick to these traditional methods of assessment? Why do we still think in terms of national qualifications now, when we do have an alternative to approach it more creatively and change something? And our findings really show evidence and desire for making these changes. So I would say it needs to be, something needs to be done.
Thank you very much.
If we're finding post-COVID, as everybody else in the world is, that there's a level of disengagement, shouldn't that be more of an incentive to make school more interesting and rewarding for students, rather than say, let's get back to the old stuff and get these kids in? They've changed, and we may need to change the system. That may be an incentive rather than a discouragement to changing the system.
Thank you for your excellent answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rennie. Pam Duncan-Glancy, over to yourself now.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you for your candour, particularly in the recent answers. I think there is no greater need to do something than some of the points we've heard about inequality that were made earlier by Dr. Shapiro and others. And so it's to that I'd like to move now. One of the reasons I said that yesterday to the Cabinet Secretary that I thought reform was important is because the attainment gap remains so stubborn. So can I ask the panel, first of all, before I go into detail on that, although it's related, is there a risk that without examination at SCQF level 5, there's more pressure on pupils at hires? And given what you said earlier on, Dr. Shapiro, how will that affect our poorest students?
Dr. Shabira.
Sorry, can you repeat the last part of the question? It's a little bit of an echo, so I'm not sure I captured that.
No problem, I probably waffled a little bit as well. So the specific question is there a risk that without examination at SCQF level 5, there's more pressure on pupils at hires, and what would the impact on poorer students be of that?
So the question is about whether having examinations at National 5 level puts extra pressure on students and affects their performance.
Without having examinations? So no exams at that point and only exams at hires?
I don't think we have sort of solid evidence about that, but it's certainly we try to understand how the existing system works, and we certainly could see that the requirement of taking qualifications on National 5 level 8, it is directly the number of qualifications, number of subjects, number of passes on National 5 levels, it directly linked to the way students make a transition to the uptake of higher qualifications, and subsequently on the way they pass these qualifications. So overall, I think it can bring us back to the question of what type of assessments we use and what we assess, and I think there are two separate issues here. More subjects needs to be taken up and learned on lower levels of qualifications overall, including the National 5 level. Do we need to assess them using examinations? That's another question. Are there other ways of assessment? Are there other ways of ensuring, for example, using continuous assessment, formative assessment? There must be other ways to ensure that young people, they master the knowledge that is being offered on this particular level, and then they are able to make a transition to the higher level qualifications and then sit the examinations. So learning on that level, definitely. Whether they need to do exams on National 5 level, it's, I think, really the issue that we need to consider and decide whether we need to change the way we assess learning outcomes on National 5 level, how we use assessment, which forms of assessment, alternative forms of assessment, and that could be beneficial to making this transition to the higher level of qualifications and final exams.
Thank you. Professor Stobart, did you want...
Just to make the point again, that Scottish students are under far more pressure than other senior secondary students around the world, because they're taking three sets of exams, many of them. Around the world, most systems end at 18 with a diploma that you can have built up to over 2 or 3 years, but we're not getting the famous two-term dash anywhere else. Outside the British system, hardly anybody examines nationally at 16. And I've made the point in the paper that in England, education's compulsory till 18, but we take what was a leaving exam at 16. And the same is true in Ireland, and the same is here. Formerly, that was a leaving certificate, if you like, for students at 16, many of whom would leave school. 88% of Scottish students carry on in the system. How much is that kind of exam needed? And the opportunities to do other things at that point and provide... Again, the British system, you leave school without any recognition other than a few certificates. No certificates if you've not done well in the exams. Other schools have diplomas, graduations and the like. And I think that was the the push we had. Why not, if you like, celebrate the end of compulsory education with a broad description of what students will do? And that's the idea of the project and the like, which other systems have, the International Baccalaureate and the like. You do projects and you defend yourself orally and you do other things. So there is the broader curriculum there. I better stop. I'm getting excited.
Thank you, Professor
Take Stobart. Me medication.
and I know that Dr. Brown, you want to come in, and then I've got one further question.
Just a very quick answer. I mean, I think you're talking about bypasses. Bypass is a big issue for students who are coming from disadvantaged schools. In my view, this goes back to this disjointed nature of the curriculum. If we really had a 3-18, what you would be doing is you would be building up your knowledge, and then when you decided you weren't taking a subject any further, then you would do some sort of qualification through an assessment that could be anything. But then if you were taking it on, then you would do that assessment at that point. So you effectively, instead of, you know, trying to do assessments in everything, you don't do that. But it goes back to the fact that we need that assessment all the way through that actually allows somebody to say, I've had enough, I don't want to take the subject any further, but you've got all the evidence there already. You don't have to go through anything else, and that's what's valued by society.
Thank you. Do you want to come back in?
Just a quick comment. I don't think we can discuss changing the way we assess knowledge and whether we remove some national examinations without seeing education as a part of the broader system. You know, we can change whatever we like, but unless, let's say, universities change their entry requirements, these changes wouldn't work. Not just the universities, in the modern society, we all use qualifications as a proof of having some level of skills and knowledge. If we don't have these official qualifications, what else is going to be used? National diploma, certificate, other ways of acknowledging learning. But this needs to be developed in interconnectivity. We can't just change one element of the entire system, which is linked for so many other things: employers, labor market, higher education, further education. So again, it's just a systemic issue. And if we want to change, we need to think about this, all the consequences.
Thank you. And the interconnectedness of each part of the system and that kind of lifelong linear learning that you described is crucial. Thank you for those answers. Now, specifically, going back to the point of socioeconomic disadvantage, in your paper ahead of today, Dr. Shapira, you noted that the curriculum is narrowing, but that is socially stratified. And has disproportionately affected students from disadvantaged backgrounds. Could you tell us a bit about why that is, what you would change, and how that might be affecting the attainment gap?
Yeah, thank you. It's a really good question how this can be changed. It needs to be changed because we can see very clear link, very clear connection between social disadvantage and type of curriculum young people are being exposed to. And this connection needs to be eliminated.
To just ask, when you say the type of curriculum they're being exposed to, do you mean the subjects they're being presented for and assessing that as opposed to looking at who's attaining what at the other side of it?
First of all, in schools in the areas of social economic disadvantage, students are being presented to smaller number of subjects. Yeah, definitely. And then relatedly, they also pass less subjects on different levels. There are lots of reasons for that. Some of the reasons are about school resources, about availability of subject teachers. But again, I'm going back to this issue of accountability and performativity cultures. in schools in social and economic disadvantaged areas, school resources are very often being focused on students who are performing better. On those who can be successfully be put through higher level qualifications and to achieve better outcomes, and then more students are being left behind, just letting them to do less qualifications to them, lower level of qualifications, and not really providing them with a valuable education experience. So this again is linked to that, the way currently the schools are being made accountable. And these ways really also need to be changed. We need to think accountability is very important, but we really need to think what kind of data is being used for this accountability. What is being used at the moment is just number of passes at National 5 higher level of qualifications and positive destinations. This is not enough, because this is not what secondary education is about. This is not what curriculum excellence is about. So this creativity, this ability to think how to use the data for accountability and what kind of data we need for the accountability is really important. And this is something that would allow to cut this link between deprivation and low quality of educational experiences.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And we are going to extend the questioning a little bit longer, because I know AI is quite a hot topic, but and Ben McPherson is going to lead on that for us this morning.
Thank you, Convener. As the Convener said, a number of you have mentioned AI already. And just to start off with, I want to give you the opportunity to just talk about what are the risks and opportunities in your view of AI. For example, should we be making proactive steps just now to make sure that our young people know how to use AI and how to use it effectively? How should certification practices work in the future? How do we confront this reality that is something that's going to affect not just our education system but society more widely?
Just a little question. Just, you know, it's like quite, we know it's, whatever you say today might not be valid tomorrow in terms of this very fast-paced change, but Dr. Shapira, if you come in first, please.
The way we think in the university about AI, and it was quite an interesting process when I think approximately a year ago it was almost the moral panic of what we are going to do. You know, all students are going to write their essays just using AI, and gradually it developed now into acknowledgement that it can be used creatively, it can be used to enable learning in so many different ways. And yes, it is not going to be easy. It would demand from everyone, you know, to engage and think, what does it mean, the existence of AI? What does it mean to the way we teach, to the way we assess, to the way we think about knowledge? But I think we're at the beginning of a very interesting process, and I'm really glad that we stopped thinking about AI as some, you know, bogeyman, but about something which is going to be used to improve our lives, improve educational experiences. So hopefully in schools this kind of thinking would be also adopted. But it's, I understand it's a very general sort of comment, but this is as far as we got at the moment.
Gordon has indicated he wants to come in as a Janet, so Gordon.
My guess is that students have been using AI with their phones for ages and distorting images and doing this and the like. So it's not come as a surprise to them. It's come as a surprise to us, probably more. And it does have that kind of instant threat to things like coursework. If I set the university, if I set an essay, has it been written by some? So I... For me, One of the ways of dealing with this is this shift to say, why don't we let teachers continuously assess their students in the classroom with what they see, what they hear, and everything else? And that gives you a kind of feel for what the students actually know. The idea of increasing the oral component where people defend, which is what happens at higher level, the Viva and the like, is really to demonstrate you've understood the work that's come in your thesis. Can you answer questions about it? So that, again, it could help in broadening teaching and learning that way. I mean, I don't have any clever answers about how we handle it if somebody, you know, in terms of I can download an essay, do I have to defend it or do I have to correct it or what?
Janet?
I think I agree with Marina. I think it's really important to think about the two sides. I mean, there is the negative side that says, you know, we've got to learn how to deal with it. And it's just a blunt statement. We have to learn how to deal with it. And students have been cutting and pasting for years and learning essays verbatim for years that they've regenerated in an exam. So there has been software generated to deal with that, and that's happened in whether it's in project work or whether it's somewhere else. It is possible to do stuff like that. So bottom line is we've just got to work out how to do it because it will be used. But the interesting thing, I said a little bit earlier on that the committee was looking at all of the reports that are out there and looking, trying to explain. We all pored through them. We read through every single report. One individual is an expert, or is very familiar with AI, and he used AI to analyse all of the reports. And it made his life so much easier, and he came out with as good an answer as we did. So for me, that's the positive. It saves time, it allows you to analyse things, it allows you to see the content of something. You can ask a question, you can go back and read it yourself and do something else, but it actually does give you a different perspective on something. So I think we've got to stop being scared of it, because I think being scared of it means we just try and stop it happening, and we can't stop it happening. Similarly, we need to find ways to assess things that are done in teams, things that are done out of school, things that are done online. We've got to work out how to deal with the new reality, because that's where we are. So for me, AI, you know, if you listen to Elon Musk and Rishi Sunak and the fact that we're all going to be dead in 100 years, then I think we'll just be really upset. But if we actually sit and think, what could we use this for from a positive perspective, not just be frightened?
Sorry to interrupt you. So in that spirit, do we need to be proactive in helping our young people to be able to use AI, have those skills? Because, for example, touch typing, we didn't take the opportunity to teach every young person how to touch type, and you know, we're behind on that. So let's get ahead on AI, should we?
Well, we should get ahead on AI, absolutely, definitely. But we should also get ahead on AI on teaching our kids how to learn and deal with social media, that learn and deal with how do they get the right knowledge from the Wikipedia that they look at every day. So there's a whole dimension of additional learning that we need to put in place. But that means we've got to take something out. We've got to decide what we are not going to teach in the curriculum. Because arguably, learning how to deal with AI, learning how to deal with the new world is more important to this and next generation than some of the stuff that we're currently teaching in schools. And we need to be open and honest, and we're willing to talk about that. We no longer teach ancient Greek. We no longer teach Latin. What else do we need to actually think about?
Well, Professor Humes, you're been keen to come in on this as well. Yeah.
Yes, it's not an area that I have expertise in, but I think it is an area that we should all be concerned about. I think there are big integrity issues associated with AI, and it relates to what I said earlier about the assault on knowledge and truth. Having said that, I'm sure there are positive advantages to what AI can offer, and if I could make one recommendation, that you all have a look at a website called AI in Education, which has recently been launched by the historian Sir Anthony Seldon. And he has brought in a lot of people with technical expertise, but his position is educationists need to be at the forefront of how we respond to this. And Anthony Seldon, of course, has worked in the private sector of education, but I was pleased to see that there are a lot of state schools in England and one independent school in Scotland who has signed up for this. I'm sure there is work going on in Scotland. I think there are staff in Education Scotland who are looking into this, but Anthony Seldon is a big player, and I think that anything he puts his name to will certainly be worth looking at. And he indicates the work they're doing, the networks he has set up, and I think it will be a useful resource.
Thank you, Professor. Marina, you indicated very briefly earlier that you wanted to come back in on this. Do you want a final comment from yourself?
In relation to your comments about us being more proactive, so just wanted to offer one good example how AI can be used in teaching and assessment proactively with students and maybe with in the final stage of secondary education as well. Students are being asked to use AI to write an essay on a particular topic, and then they are being told to critically assess this essay using the knowledge they gain from literature, from lectures, from this to that, and then use this critical assessment to write a proper essay. And for me, that was excellent example how it can be used creatively, proactively, and still contribute to better outcome.
And I think, if I may, that is a very good example of the facts we also need to keep in mind, that even if and when AI is working perfectly, it is not perfect because it is reliant on the data on which it can access, and our ability to create data and to critically analyse what AI generates is going to be an important skill as well. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's a great place to finish the morning. We are still in the morning, and I'd like to thank the panel for their time and their contributions, and yes, for accepting our little bit extended time as well. So that concludes the public part of our proceedings today. Thank you very much.